Continuing with the study of CW complexes, now we take up the topic of homotopical aspects. One of the easy consequences of the so much of study of the product that we did, once you have a CW complex X, X cross I will be automatically a CW complex now. Because I itself is a CW complex which is compact. Therefore, construction on functions, continuous functions on X cross I, which is same thing as homotopy, becomes easy. So this is the first theorem that we have here. Take X be a CW complex. A function X cross I to Y is continuous if and only if restricted to each xk cross I, all these restrictions are continuous for each k greater than or equal to 0. What is its xk? Xk is kth skeleton. So all that I have to say that the co-induced topology with respect to this family xk cross I on so in the entire x cross I, the same thing as the ordinary product topology, which we know is equal to the co-induced topology on X cross I. The co-induced topology on X cross I is a general thing, namely by compactly generated sets. Or you can take co-induced topology on X, which is through this family X, and then take the usual topology on I, and then take the product and see what is happening. Okay. So whichever either two ways you have to do. So what I do, look at the identity map from X cross I, the co-induced topology, namely X cross I W to X cross I. This is homeomorphism because X has compactly generated topology and I is compact. Okay, therefore, function F is continuous on X cross I, if and only if F restricted to X cross I, the kth skeleton of this is continuous for each I, because I have to verify it from this topology. The kth skeleton of X cross I is, remember, it is the union of various, we can take XI skeleton and then a jth skeleton, but I has only two skeletons, 0 and 1. So it is xk cross 0 union xk minus 1 cross I, right? Those are the two skeletons. In any case, for each k, what happens is the kth skeleton of this one is obviously contained in xk cross I, which is the full k plus 1 complex. And that is contained inside the k plus 1 skeleton of x cross I comma w. So these closed subsets are trapped between these two things. Therefore, whether the co-induced topology is with respect to this family or with respect to this family, they are the same. So once you have this ready-made criteria, what you do is you construct homotopies on the zero skeleton, extend it on the one skeleton, extend it on the two skeleton and so on as homotopies, then you put them together, automatically it will be a continuous function from on X cross I. So this is the idea of this theorem. This is how it will be, this theorem will be used now. Now, this is the central result for all homotopy aspects of CW complexes. So which we have prepared long back, right in the beginning, in proposition 2.1, that U be an open subset or a closed subset where XA is a relative CW complex. Starting with, say, U minus 1, this is just an indexing of U intersection A. Put UN equal to U intersection the nth skeleton of XA, n greater than or equal to 0. Suppose the n minus 1 subset, un minus 1, is a strong deformation retract of un. Each of them, anyway, un is contained in un plus 1, because this is the nth skeletons keep increasing. Okay, so successively, u minus 1 is a SDR of u0, u0 is SDR of u1, and so on. So for each n, okay, un minus 1 is a strong deformation retract to un. Then u minus 1 will be a strong deformation retract of the whole u. So this is a statement. Okay, so this un minus 1 to un, okay, this is one stage, but this is true for all n. Then you can hit the u. U itself will be strong deformation retract, will deformation retract to u minus 1. U minus 1 is an STR of u. The easy part here is each un minus 1 is a retract of un. Then we know composites, you can take composites or retractions. Retractions, two retractions, you take composite, the composite is retraction. So you can take finitely many composites. Each un will retract to u minus 1. That's easy. After that, u will be a retract because I can define the retraction on u to be these composites depending upon where my n is, where my x is. Every x is inside some Rn. Sorry, inside some un, right? Because every x is in some xa and n skeleton. Okay, it may be starting u minus 1 itself, there's nothing to do. There you define it as the n composition. So that is the easier part. The thing is how to get homotopy. You can't compose homotopies so easily because they are not dominant codomains are different. So let us go through it carefully. Let Fn from un cross I to un be a homotopy of the identity map, and which is relative to un minus 1 because all the points of un are fixed. Okay. Fn of x0 is x is identity map to begin with. And then what you have is the nth comment, the nth function fn of x, which is fn of x comma 1, this is by definition. Okay. That is a deformation retraction. That's a retraction, whatever. Un to un minus 1 automatically, once you have such a thing. Okay. So whole thing is taking place inside n, but fn of x comma t, we don't stick for all x in un minus 1, t is in fn of x is in 0. Okay, therefore, it's a function from un to un minus 1. And on un, as soon as points are in un minus 1, it is identity. So this is the hypothesis that is given, that each un minus 1 is a strong deformation retraction of un. Okay. So the last map, which is retraction, I have taken fn. Okay. This is a strong deformation retract for each n. That is the meaning given by fn itself. There is nothing more than that. Therefore, if I take composites, gn is f0, f1, fn, we get a strong deformation retract gn from un to u minus 1. Okay. I don't know that, but I can definitely say that this is a retraction. Okay. So we don't know whether it is a strong deformation retraction, but we will see that soon. Okay. Observe that n plus 1th function here, restricted to un, is just gn. Why? Because gn plus 1 is all these composite with fn plus 1. But fn plus 1 is identity on un. It is a function from un plus 1 to un, which is an attraction. So it will be just the rest of this. Fn plus 1, you compose it first, fn plus 1 of some x. If it's an element of un, it will be just x itself, and then rest of them is gn. So this is the important thing here. Therefore, if I define g as gnx, whenever x is in un, this will be well-defined function on the whole of u. Then this map will be actually from u to u minus 1. Okay, and this is retraction because points of u minus 1, all of them keep fixed. Okay, so I get a retraction. However, to show that it is a strong deformation retract, we have to work a little harder. Okay, all that I get is retract. I don't care whether this G is a deformation retract or strong deformation retract. I will have to prove that one yet. There is no way of directly getting it. Okay. Yeah, so that step is a lesson here in getting how to get compositions of deformation retracts or homotopies in general. What composition? Infinite compositions. Okay. So you have to watch it carefully. Okay, that itself maybe the step itself will be useful elsewhere also. So look at here what I do. I start with F naught. Okay. And this first half of the interval, I will keep it idle, identity. Then I take F naught. So this is my G naught. So I'm trying to define a successive way of composing. Okay. So in the next step, I define G1. So this time, up to 1/3 interval, it is idle. Idle means identity map. No change. Then whatever F1 is there, 1/3 to 1 by 2, I'll put that F1 here. Okay, remember all these FIs are homotopies of the identity. So on this line, they will be identity. So they will match up. Okay. Now this at the end, I have got some F1 or F0, little F1. You take the homotopy of that on this side. Okay, you put G0 here. Okay. So next step, I will cut down this one again. Identity up to 1/4 itself. Then whatever F2 you have got, you plug in that one here. And then the entire earlier stage G1, this entire thing reparameterized from 1/3 to 1. So put that one here. So this is where so at the nth stage, 0 to 1 by n, it will be identity. 1 by n to the next 1 by n plus 1, it will be fn minus 1 or fn whatever. And then the earlier homotopy which you have constructed. This is the way I'm going to do. Okay, this is just a schematic way, but now I will have to write down exactly. So define Gn inductively, okay? Gn from un cross I to un inductively as follows. G naught of xt, this step was g1, g2, gn, so inductively defined how? G naught of xt is x in the first half of the interval. Then it is f naught of x, 2t minus 1. Half less than t less than. All that you have to say is that when t equal to half, there are two definitions, they must coincide. Okay. When t equal to half, what is this? This f naught of x? 0. So it is identity. This is identity here. So for n greater than equal to 1, having defined gn minus 1, you define gn as x in the interval 0 to 1 by n plus 2. If n is 1, this is 1/3. Okay, like this here. Second stage is 1/3. Okay. From 1 by 1 divided over n plus 2 to 1 divided n plus 1, you put fn of x appropriately, you know, scaled. You have to appropriately scale. This the thing is the thing that you have to write correctly. Okay. For example, when t equal to 1 divided by n plus 2, what it this will be? N plus 2, n plus 2 cancels out. So this 1 minus 1, it will be 0. Okay, this is fn of x0. Okay. When t equal to 1 by n plus 1, this will be n plus 2 divided by n plus 1, which is 1 divided by n plus 1. Minus 1, n plus 1 cancels away. So this will be what? This will be equal to 1 divided by n plus 2. No, sorry, not 1 by n plus 2. Fn of x1 it will be. So like that, you have to see this, that they match up. Okay. So here you take gn minus 1 of, not gn minus 1 itself, but put fn of x there. So this is the difference which was not explained here, what g1 I have put, but this is just a diagram, okay? So that at n equal to, at t equal to 1 divided by 1 plus n, this will coincide with fn of xt, little fn of x1 it will coincide. Okay, so definition of gn is clear, how to one does it. Now, having inductively, we now verify that each gn is a strong deformation retract of un into u minus 1. So this was the claim there. Okay, but there we knew only retraction. Now it is proved that each un retracts to u minus 1 in a strong deformation way. Moreover, gn restricted un minus 1 cross I is gn minus 1. Whenever it is inside un minus 1, it is gn minus 1. Therefore, there is a well-defined map g from u cross I to u given by g of xt equal to gn of xt whenever x is inside u. If v is an open subset of u, I have to show that why this is continuous, but this is more or less obvious from the co-induced topology. Big topology. What is the inverse image? G inverse of V. G inverse of V intersection with n skeleton. The same thing as G inverse of V intersects with UN. But that is G inverse of V intersection. UN is what? XA n skeleton. Okay. And at GNth level, it is a continuous function, so this is an open subset of xan for each n. So this means g inverse of v is open inside u. Okay. Therefore, g is a continuous function. So that g is a strong deformation retract of u into u minus 1 is directly verified. Because once from something is in u minus 1, all the time, no matter what the second coordinate are there, these functions will fix the point. No matter what, they are all of them are identity gn of x. This fn of x is also x, gn of that one is also x, and so on. Okay, so that's why it is a strong deformation retraction of u onto u minus 1. Now we can have nice theorems like this, which we want to remember forever. You may not be able to remember immediately how this is constructed. You may just, whereas you should remember this way, the picture here. Then these formulas, nobody remembers them. You have to work it out by yourself so that things match up correctly. What you want, two functions are two continuous functions, when they define continuous function on the intersection of these two, on the neighborhoods, on the set of points where in that, and they must be agree. That's all. That kind of things is what you have to do. Okay. So, what is the theorem? Theorem is that every CW complex is locally contractible. Right in the beginning, we told you that these CW complexes must be having lots of Euclidean property. Every Euclidean space, every open subset is locally contractible. Okay, inside Rn. So that property is here also. Later on, when we define manifolds, you'll see that manifolds are locally contractible because they are locally actually Euclidean spaces. So CW complexes have that property. It's a very important property. So how do we prove this one? What is the meaning of locally contractible, first of all? Given a point X and an open subset V containing that point, we have to have a subset of that which is open and a containing X, and that must be contractible. There is slightly weaker versions also, but we are not satisfied with weaker version. We are going to prove the stronger version. So every open set contains an open set, okay, contains a neighborhood of that point, which is contractible. That point, that neighborhood is contractible. This is what we have to prove. All right. So using the previous lemma, this homotopy lemma, whatever, okay, what we want to do is we want to construct it inductively, okay, skeleton wise. So this construction is done inductively. To begin with, there is a unique open cell EK in X to which X belongs to. So this is again and again used. What is that? Namely, a CW complex is disjoint union of its open cells. So take the open cell to which the given point X belongs to. Okay. First, choose a contractible neighborhood UK of X in EK, because EK is a Euclidean. It is some diffeomorphic to some homeomorphic to some DK, right? There you can find intersect it to be, that will be an open set inside DK. X belongs to that open set. Inside that, you can actually choose a neighborhood which is like a ball, homeomorphic to an epsilon ball. So that will be locally contractible. So first choose a contractible neighborhood, UK, let's call it UK, of X inside EK, so that even the closure UK bar is contained inside P intersection EK bar. You can take as small as you want, and the closures will be there. The closed ball itself is there, that you can do. Now, for n greater than equal to k, having constructed the neighborhood un, so that the closure of un bar is contained inside xn intersection v, okay? So you can make this one, the y I took closure, so that this closure is compact. And such that un minus 1, the earlier thing, is a strong differential tract of un, okay? So this is inductive step. The inductive step is carried out as follows. So you have to how to take the UN, right? Once I do that, I am done, because then I put union of U and the whole thing will be over. So how to construct this UN? So let lambda be the indexing set of all n plus 1 cells. From Xn, you see, I started with Xn itself here, EK. EK itself, K great, now N up to N I have, UN minus 1 I have done. Now I want to, UN I have done this one, UN plus 1 I want to do. This inductive step is like that. Okay, U minus 1 here is actually equal to the disk, this itself, that UK bar that we have taken. Below that, there is nothing, because X itself is in the kth skeleton. right? It is in the open part of the of a care skeleton of a cell there. Okay, so from n to n plus 1, I would like to do this step now. So look at all the n plus 1 cell, index them by lambda. For each alpha and lambda, you have phi alpha inverse of un bar, which you have constructed. Un bar is compact set. Phi alpha inverse of un bar is a closed subset of Sn. So it's a compact subset of Sn. Okay, contained in the open set, phi alpha inverse of V. So a compact subset contained inside a closed subset of a compact, so compact subset inside V. So therefore, you can find an epsilon, which depends upon alpha, okay, between 0 and 1, such that if you construct, remember this step before the lemma before 2.1 is n epsilon phi alpha inverse of u alpha, that is some a, its closure is contained in phi alpha inverse of b. So all the epsilon whiskers will be contained in that is one, will be taken. So this C is an open subset, its closure is contained in v alpha. Okay, with this way, for each epsilon, for each alpha, I have chosen an epsilon, so I have a function here. Okay, then you define un plus 1 to be n epsilon of un, which is union of all these things along with un. That's the definition as defined in proposition 2.1. Now we take u equal to un. From lemma 2.2, it follows that u is a contractible neighborhood of this one. Okay. So basically, it is the lemma 2.2 which is employed here. Okay, and prior to this proposition 2.1, it is actually proposition 2.1. The next theorem is about the cofibrations and so on. So let me just begin this one with a lemma. And then you will stop and take a break. Okay, so X be obtained by Y by attaching K cells. Okay, see, it seems that all our lemmas start with this one, the inductive step for CW complexes, so that we can carry on with inductive steps, inductive constructions. So X is obtained from Y by attaching K cells. Then look at X cross 0 union Y cross I. It's a strong deformational tract of X cross I. So this is a proof. So let us go through this one and then stop. Again, let us have this family of alpha, alpha in lambda, with attaching maps for the K cells. One of the standards that we have proved in part one is that there is a strong deformation retract dk cross I, where dk is a cell, dk is just the unit disk, cross I, dk cross 0, the bottom, and only the boundary cross I. So it's like a tub, it's like a cylinder, one top open and bottom closed cylinder. That cylinder is a strong deformation retraction of, stronger retract of the full dk cross I, the full cylinder. Okay, so this is what we have, this was one of the central results in part one. Let H from union, disjoint union of dk alpha cross I to disjoint union of these things. This is the union of all such H. That means I'm taking the copies of H on each alpha. It's just the disjoint union of copies of this H. Okay. Let F from disjoint union of SK minus 1 alpha cross I to Y cross I be defined by using the attaching maps. On the first coordinate, it's F alpha of X. In the second coordinate, undisturbed T. Okay. So these are the attaching maps for all K cells. Once you have this, what is the space X? X is the quotient of Y, X cross I is a quotient of Y cross I disjoint union DK of alpha cross I, right? Because X is a quotient of Y disjoint union DK of alpha. So X cross I is a quotient of this one. This needs a proof, by the way. In general, this is not true that if X to Y is a quotient map, then X cross Z to Y cross Z is a quotient map. Okay. So you must have some hypothesis on Z, namely locally compactness and so on. So this I is a compact set, this is okay here. So this is general, this is a fact. By the one single identification, namely, this F is just composed of all F alphas, right? So F alphas is just X comma T, T factor is undisturbed, X is identified as FX. So this will give you the identification on the product X cross I as a quotient of this one. That is just Q cross I in any case. Okay, so therefore, what I have is Y cross I disjoint in DK cross I, all the cells, to Q cross identity is X cross I. I want to define a map here. Okay, I have a map here already on the top, on the product and disjoint union of these things. Okay, on each part here, it is a strong deformation retract. On the part Y, it is just identity map. Okay, this on the part Y, it is just the identity map. All right. So what you do? You have to just verify that this factors down to through quotient map. That's all. Why? Because on the boundary wherein F alphas are being identified, it is identity map. The entire homotopy is identity map there. That is why it works. So you have got a map here. To verify that this is a strong differentiator, you have to verify it here. So let us stop here and continue next time. And we will come back to this important result, how we are going to use this one. Thank you.